Hello everyone, I welcome all of you to this brief session of understanding the theory of classical conditioning. Now before moving on, let us have a look on what we will be studying here. After watching this unit, we will be able to understand what classical conditioning is, definition of classical conditioning, the experiment which Pavlov conducted in this respect, and what are the factors affecting conditioning, and how it is applicable in the field of education. Now, Ivan P. Pavlov was a Russian physiologist who discovered classical conditioning, and he was the first Russian Nobel laureate to win a Nobel Prize for his research work on digestive process in 1904. He was basically studying the process of gastric secretions in dogs. Now, here we can see the Pavlov's experimental setup. Pavlov especially designed an apparatus for measuring how much dog's mouth salivates or waters in response to food. A cup was attached to the dog's cheek, which collected drops of saliva flowing from the animal's salivary gland. During his experimental work on dogs, he noticed a phenomenon of secretion of saliva in dogs on the side of the food or a sound of the caretaker's approaching footsteps. This psychic secretion or the phenomena of secretion of saliva in dogs on the sight of the food form the basis of this classical conditioning. A further understanding of Pavlov experiment in three phases, that is before conditioning, during conditioning and after conditioning. Before conditioning, you can see the situation is normal. Natural, that is on the side of the food, dog began to salivate. And what happens then? To condition the dog, Pavlov rang a bell before providing the food to the dog. Each time the food was provided, a bell rang before. What happened? Constant pairing of the bell with the food conditioned the dog, and now he began to salivate as soon as the bell rang. Hence, the dog has been conditioned to the sound of the bell. Now, there are certain terms which need to be explained with respect to the experiment. First is unconditioned stimulus. Unconditioned stimulus, because when we put food in the mouth of the dog salivates. This response on the part of the food is natural and unfailing. Food is called the unconditioned stimulus, and the salivation by the dog is called unconditioned response. The stimulus food is called unconditioned stimulus because it conveys the meaning that response depends upon no special condition. An unconditioned response is unlearned and implies no preconditioning. And with the introduction of the sound of the bell, a neutral stimulus introduced, which evokes no response on the first presentation. Then after a number of pairing of conditioned stimulus and unconditioned stimulus, the conditioned stimulus is presented alone to the dog without unconditioned stimulus, that is food. What we observe that the conditioned stimulus, that is the bell, sound of the bell, succeed in eliciting the response, that is saliva. When we call it, then we call this a conditioned stimulus, and salivation, that is response, is called conditioned response. And now we have reached a state where we can actually define what classical conditioning is. It is written, a process in which a neutral stimulus by pairing with natural stimulus acquires all the characteristic of natural stimulus. That is, the neutral stimulus was the bell. The bell on pairing with the natural stimulus, that is the food, acquires all the characteristics of natural stimulus. That is, bell itself is able to evoke all the responses which a natural stimulus usually does. Now, this classical conditioning is also called substitution learning, because we substitute a neutral stimulus in place of natural stimulus for conditioning, and it is often referred as signal learning. we can see that the bell, the conditioned stimulus, acts as a signal for unconditioned response. There are certain phenomena of classical conditioning which need to be explained. I will be dealing it separately in further slides. First is the intensity. Gastric secretion is the function of a kind of food. So there is a positive correlation between the intensity of the stimulus and the magnitude of the response. The better the stimulus, the better the response. And a negative correlation between the intensity of stimulus and latency of response. If the stimulus is unfavorable, it is unattractive, so there will be latency in response. Temporal relation between conditioned stimulus and unconditioned stimulus. Psychologists have manipulated systematically the time interval between conditioned stimulus and unconditioned stimulus. It has been reported that an interval of half a second between conditioned stimulus and unconditioned stimulus produces the greatest amount of conditioning. If the time interval is shorter than half a second, particularly if the interval is negative, so that the unconditioned stimulus follows conditioned stimulus, a dramatic failure of conditioning occurs. So there should be no delayed conditioning or backward conditioning, but it is observed that the interval of half a second produces the greatest amount of conditioning. Another phenomenon related to the experiment is extinction. If there is no pairing of conditioned stimulus and unconditioned stimulus, there will be no response, there will be no salivation. For a long time, when the conditioned stimulus is not followed by the unconditioned stimulus, the pairing between the two weakens and a stage arrives when the dog forgets conditioning and no longer secretes saliva. This is called extinction. Spontaneous recovery. It has been reported by the psychologist when the dog is brought out of the experimental setup and again put in the setup after a lapse of time, the dog responds to the conditioned stimulus by salivating. This phenomena indicates that there is no complete extinction due to time interval, but there is an inhibition of conditioned response. Now, what is inhibition? It may be defined as a process in which the stimulus inhibits a response that would otherwise occur. Pavlov described two types of inhibitions, external inhibition and internal inhibitions. Externals are related to external factors, external influences like noise or any other distractions, and internal is related to physical health of the organism or its preoccupation with some other activity, motivation, etc. Now we will see how this theory of classical conditioning is applicable in the field of education. Development of good habits, at the same time breaking of bad habits. It helps in developing new habits, attitudes and emotions in younger children. Habits related with the punctuality, cleanliness, studying and other habits formation are also possible through classical conditioning. Elimination of conditioned fears. Conditioned fears can be removed through conditioning and many phobic reactions can be eliminated. Application in psychotherapy. Drug de-addiction, phobia elimination and other hysterical cases are treated by applying it as a psychotherapeutic measure. It is very useful in training of animals. For entertainment purposes, in circus and other purposes, the animals are trained and this classical conditioning is employed in training of animals. Now with this, we come to the end of a unit. Thank you.